Well, a couple of things. Number one, I think you're going to have David Schaefer on later. He's been the head of the GOP down here in Georgia. He's done a great job of actually raising the awareness of our poll workers and the observations, the things that need to happen at the really base level of watching our elections, making sure absentee ballots are brought in. But also there's been an awareness, and I think the biggest difference here, and I think some of the campaigns of Senator Perdue and Senator Leffler are making sure that people get out to vote. This has been something in which I believe the timing has made it very difficult for people to realize that there is a vote coming up. But although the votes are coming in, we still see a lot of trend lines that are very good for Republicans who vote on Election Day. Those numbers are still out there. We're still seeing some good results in some other areas. So it's just going, the biggest thing here is just the realization that Georgia truly does hold the nation captive right now. If we can hold these two Senate seats, then Schumer has blocked, and we need to keep that up.
And we should note that the state of Georgia has recruited 8,000 volunteers for poll watchers, which is really, really, I think, pretty unprecedented in the state's history. You mentioned these two candidates. They're both far left liberals. They're socialists even. They support raising taxes by trillions. One analysis puts Georgia near the top of the list of states that stand to lose under the Biden economic plan. Warnock has attacked cops and the military. He thinks that abortion is a Christian or biblical principle. But what we look at these polls, though, Congressman, why is this race still so tight?
Well, I think that one of the biggest things for polls is people watch TV, they see stuff, and we've had over $500 million dropped into this state on both sides. And so I think it's a close. But look, Georgia has never been a 10 or 15 point state. It's always been about an eight point state, a swing. And it's gotten closer here in the last couple of elections for various reasons. But I think one of the things that's been very obvious, and you just pointed it out a second ago, John Ossoff, I'm not sure where it is. One of my colleagues called him as a trust fund socialist. I mean, he has been given everything in life, and he's worked with communist China and other places in the Middle East with Al Jazeera and others. And then you've got Reverend Warnock, who, look, I'm a pastor. I'm an Air Force chaplain for 19 years. I don't find a biblical value in killing an unborn in the womb. And I'm not sure how you can be a pro-choice pastor. I'm not sure how your interpretation of scripture has that. But also the raising of taxes, the attacking of cops. Both sides have really, they have just shown themselves to be the liberals that they are. And that's why I believe that this race will turn at the end. Georgia does not want these kind of liberal values, and they're going to fight to protect that. And the Trump voter down here has an obligation, I believe, to come back out, because this is important to make sure that we keep the conservative values in the Senate.
Now, you mentioned the president and some of his surrogates have lashed out at Georgia Republicans, calling for Brian Kemp to resign. The president yesterday tweeted that the Senate election was, quote, illegal and invalid. Do you think that that this has harmed some of the kind of unity and energy that is necessary to drive out that vote that's so critical to win these close races?
I think it's important that we keep in mind there's two different factors going in here. One is the problem of November 3rd, and we cannot ignore that. In fact, you're going to be hearing a lot more from me in the coming weeks about how we can bring back election integrity, not from the disinformation of Stacey Abrams and her groups, but actually what can we actually do to make sure that our elections are safe and secure and actually have a proper vote. But you have to make sure you separate it out, that no matter what frustration you feel, and the president's expressed this as well. He's expressed a lot of frustration with Georgia, but he's also expressed a very strong opinion that Dave Perdue and Kelly Leffler have to be reelected, and he's going to be here again on Monday to support that. Mm-hmm. And so it's really two things. You got to keep focus on what happened, but you also got to look ahead. You can't take your eye off the ball. You can't get mad because of what happened and not support these two senators, because if you do, then you're giving up the socialist win if we stay right at home. We've got to have everybody turn out.
I want to move forward to Wednesday and that Electoral College vote. Now, you've been talking a lot about these election irregularities. We all have. Are you right now assisting any members of Congress with their efforts to present arguments on the 6th to support their objections to Georgia's electoral votes? And do you expect that those votes at the end of the day will end up standing?
Well, seeing how it come tomorrow at 12 o'clock, I'll be a former member of Congress from that. But I've also been working, and they see what's happened down here in Georgia and across the country. What these representatives are wanting to do is highlight what actually happened. I mean, I think it's as we well know, and it's been reported, it's an uphill battle. But this is a contest that, it's amazing to me that mainstream media is making such a big deal about many of these contesting. Now, whether you agree with it or not is a different factor. But they're actually highlighting the irregularities that happened in this November 3rd election. And I don't remember the complaining and the loud moaning from the mainstream media when the Democrats did it for basically the last four elections. And in fact, in 2005, actually called for this vote. So again, let's have the vote and we'll see what happens. But it'll allow the people to see what actually happened in states all across the country, Pennsylvania and others, in which the election laws were changed outside of an action of the legislatures in those states.
Well, it's certainly a conversation that needs to be elevated, and the president has done that. Congressman, you mentioned this. Today is your last full day as a member of Congress, at least for the time being. How do you feel? How do you feel leaving the institution, the constituent work, the constituents that you've served so well? And what's next for Doug Collins?
Well, it's sort of a bittersweet day. I look back on 8 years of life in Congress and look at some great things we did. The First Step Act, which the president ran for re-election on, that's criminal justice reform. That was a bill that I helped, that I authored. It was a bill that we took great pride in. We took great pride in working to make sure we held big tech accountable, help making sure that our law enforcement was taken care of, that we stood for the values as ranking member of the House Judiciary Committee. I was at the tip of the spear of the impeachment, sham impeachment that we had to go through. So I'm proud of the fight that we had. And look, in the future, I will just say this. Stay tuned. You're going to see a lot more from Doug Collins. We've got a lot to do. But as the future, I'm going to be supporting the values that I have been fighting for, this president, the Congress coming up. We've got to look ahead, especially in the House, to flip and get rid of Nancy Pelosi and AOC's. The rules package that they put together just for this new Congress is horrendous. That's why it's got to be focused on this next election to make sure Republicans take back over the House. But you'll still see me. And